Hello, Disc Center. Today I want to talk about a game that has me very excited. You see, I love games like Mountain Blade and Chivalry. Melee combat is a particular favorite of mine, a genre that I feel doesn't get enough love. There's not enough video games that cover this topic, so when something like For Honor comes out in February, it's got my attention because there's really not much competition besides the next Mountain Blade. And I guess the next game from the Torn Banner Studios Chivalry developers Mirage. For Honor is special though because I got to play it, as opposed to the other two games mentioned. For four or so hours, I was flown out by Ubisoft to San Francisco to play what you're seeing here a couple of weeks back. So if you think that factors into my opinion of the game, feel free to take what I have to say with a grain of salt, but I'm gonna give you my honest opinion. I've played it, it's a lot of fun. With all that said, let's get into why I think that. For Honor, for me, is a multiplayer-centric game. There is a single-player campaign, and up until now, you have been seeing new content from the two new single-player missions that I was able to play and sample for myself while I was there with a hands-on time. But multiplayer is my bread and butter. It's my meat and potatoes. And the reason is because the excitement, the thrill of defeating another human in combat cannot be equaled by defeating computer-controlled bosses. Especially bosses that have way more health than they should have. Multiplayer is tense by comparison because everything weighs on your actions. When you choose to block, when you choose to block break, when you choose to try to execute a combo that may leave you wide open while you wind up for a big, heavy swing. You should have figured out by now that For Honor is a combat game where you kill things with sharp objects, sometimes blunt objects that have sharp pointies attached to them. There's a number of warriors to choose from in multiplayer. I was able to select from any of 9 warriors at the time of this recording. More are going to be unveiled over time, however, taking part on one of 3 sides: the knights, the Vikings, or the samurai. Each with their own heavy, medium, and light style warriors, which, as the name implies, some are heavier, slower, but more powerful, while some are quicker, lighter, deal less damage, but evade and strike when you least expect it. For Honor walks what I think is an interesting line in terms of complexity. It is easy enough to slip into the skin of any one of these warriors and feel competent with them after a few minutes, because all the warriors, for the most part, share the same mechanics. You swing in 3 different directions, up, left, or right. You block in 3 directions, up, left, or right. Seeing where your enemy, your opponent, is slashing you next, you block that direction and you negate the attack. However, stay in block stance for too long, turtle up, and you might find yourself on the receiving end of a block breaker, which will make you vulnerable, but if you have good enough timing, you can block breaker cancel their block breaker, and then they, I think, can block breaker cancel that so that they don't become vulnerable. It's a game of timing. It's easy enough to adjust to the simple controls. Heavy attack, light attack, a couple of rudimentary combos, but knowing when to time them, knowing how far your weapon can reach, or when you should try for that really risky play, block breakering an enemy, picking them up, throwing them off of a ledge somewhere for an instant kill. Everything is all about positioning, timing, and being familiar with your character, their weapons, and their powers. Because you see, some of these warriors are designed to subvert the rules. One of the knights, for example, can block in all directions simultaneously for a brief amount of time. And some of the heavier set warriors, like the Shigoki on the samurai that was recently revealed, can attack without getting interrupted. So knowing who you're fighting against and knowing what the capabilities of your chosen warrior are will take you really far. But learning their actual movesets is fairly simple. Each one only has a handful of combos to learn. But once you do learn them, knowing when to apply them is key. That's why I say it seems to walk a fine, interesting line, because it's easy enough to get into, but the timing, positioning, and all the other complex maneuvers, when to cancel cancels, for example, is what puts it up to another level, another tier on the skill ceiling. And that excites me because I am going to practice. I'm gonna pick one guy, I'm gonna get really good at him. And in that sense, I love the similarities to a fighting game. I do feel like you could pick your favorite class, play as that class, and master it. I like the Orochi, for example. I think there's gonna be at least 12 different characters, 12 warriors, heroes, whatever you wanna call them, in the game at launch. And they're planning on adding more over time. I think that those may end up being paid DLC of some kind in the future. I don't know. I think all the DLC maps are going to be free, however, and maybe they will add some more heroes for free. I'm not sure what their business model, their practice is going to be. However, I'm excited at the fact that each of these heroes seems to bring something different to the table. For example, the Berserker, which you're seeing here, is the Vikings assassin class, and it plays completely differently from the Orochi, which is the Samurai's assassin class. The point is that these three different factions are not just mirror matches of each other. The Knights are not like the Vikings, are not like the Samurai. They all play differently. With the same pool of mechanics, yes, but they still feel differently. Use different weapons, swing at different speeds. It's different, okay? That's the point. Definitely the only thing that could ruin this game for me is if certain characters are just infinitely better than the others. Some have said, what stops the light classes from dominating the heavies? Because if the heavy takes the longest to swing, the light class can just run up there, hit them, and interrupt all of their swings, right? Wrong. Apparently stamina will be the limiting factor. The light classes swing more, use stamina more, and when you run out of stamina, you're pretty much a dead fish in a barrel. You don't even have to shoot that fish, you just grab it. When an opponent runs out of stamina, it's very obvious. When you run out of stamina, your screen turns gray, everything you want to do takes three times longer than it should. You can't sprint, you merely swagger your way away from combat, making a hapless swing out of desperation, trying not to die, waiting for that stamina to return. So I think that as a limiting factor will make the fights a lot more even. Tire out your opponent and then throw down the final blow. Speaking of final blows, executions are amazing. You've probably seen a handful of them throughout this video. Executions can grant you health, for example. So it does pay to do them, even though it leaves you open and vulnerable during that extended time. Other people may be swarming around you, ready to feast on you, while you're feasting on one of their best friends. And that's pretty easy for them to do, because a death means a HUD marker has appeared, marking the location of that corpse. And that serves two purposes. One, letting teams know where the action is happening, where someone needs to be avenged, but more importantly, where someone might be able to be revived. Your team can revive friendlies, given enough time. This can really sway the tide of combat. It cancels out their respawn timer. It adds points back to your tally. We've been playing the Dominion game mode here, where the objective is to hold the points. 3 points in total. The more you have, the more overall points you accrue. Given enough, the enemy team will start breaking and death becomes permanent. Well, except for the revives, which makes for some really exciting encounters. You think you've killed all of the enemy team, one guy remains, and he runs around the map and manages to sneak revive two of his friends, and suddenly the fight's back on. They're making a comeback, a push, returning the fire back at you, and it can wave back and forth like volleys in a tennis match. Next time, I'll show you a couple more of the game modes that I am personally a huge fan of, so I'm gonna make at least one more for Honor video, but let me know what you think about this one, please, down in the comments below. I would appreciate that very much. If any of you have gotten to play in the closed beta yourself, you have any thoughts or opinions, I'd like to hear those too, because I'm not real privy on balance and things of that nature. I've only got a handful of hours with the game so far, but I'm looking forward to more. Thank you all so much for watching. Once again, my name is Etalyx, and I'll see you next time.